Good afternoon, everyone. So I hope every UPSC aspirant would be knowing Mr. Frank Pereira. Welcome back to another session of Ignite at Insights. Hope you all had enriching learning experiences from our previous guests. Okay, so continuing with this same enthusiasm and spirit, today we have very distinguished guest amongst us whose debates and discussion on prime time shows of Rajya Sabha TV are very objective, informative and enlightening for the UPSC aspirants and overall for everyone, which has not only raised the standards of national TV, but also has become a benchmark for getting quality and relevant content for UPSC mains exam. So sir, thank you so much for obliging the request of the students, obliging our request, and it is honor and pleasure to host you and welcome you. I will request Vinay sir to welcome Frank sir officially.
Thank you.
So sir, the stage is yours. And
I must say it's a good color to choose on a historic day today.
So sir will be taking, already we have discussed that sir will be taking West Asia and India's West Asia policy. Sir, we have map also. We have
map. I'll tell you when I need the map.
Yes.
Let me start off.
So now sir will start.
Yeah. Welcome, thank you, sir. Himanshu, for this wonderful introduction. Thank you, Vinay, for having me here. It's really a pleasure. It's an honor, a privilege to be amongst you all. I say that not because of anything else, but before that, I must tell you, the moment I walked into that door, the first reaction I had was, let me run away. Because I have not seen so many people, so many intelligent, intellectual people as a bunch ever. Before I say intelligent and intellectual because I have interacted with several UPSC aspirants over the last 7 years, 10 years. I have only seen bright people when I interact with UPSC aspirants. I think you are some of the brightest minds that we have around, and we are really lucky to have you all in our presence. So thank you for having me here, and it's really a pleasure to be with you all. I say pleasure and privilege also because someone shared the results of your intranet poll with me, one on Twitter, one personally, and one on WhatsApp, I think. So 60% of you wanted to see me here. Thank you very much. The other 40%, please leave. Okay, so before I speak about India's West Asia policy, I just want to give you a brief background about India's foreign policy, or an overview of India's foreign policy and what drives it at this juncture. Let's not forget that the last 6 years, we've seen a man who has led from the front, very strong leadership, who has built a personal connect with other strong world leaders. I think this is the first time in history where we've seen several strong leaders come together. Otherwise, history has always shown us that on the one side you had the US, on the other hand you had, America, and those were the two real big powers that, you know, fought it out or did whatever else it is, or decided which way world policy should steer. But in the last 6 years, we've seen a difference. The French president is strong. German chancellor, of course, is on a weak wicket now because of what's happening personally in her country. But otherwise, we've had someone who's been strong and leading from the front. India still has a very strong leader. Donald Trump, I mean, I don't know what to call him. strong or not, I really don't know. His policy is driven by Twitter, I think. That's one good thing, because everyone knows what the US president's policy is. So all we have to do is wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning and look at your Twitter account. Follow Trump, you know what's happening in the US, or what at least President Trump is thinking about. That poses a big challenge for the American diplomats, though, I must say, because for them, they have to do a lot of damage control after what Trump says. But anyways, coming back to the point, I don't want to waste too much of my time basically, you know, beating around the bush. But so strong leaders. So India too is helmed by a very, very strong leader, and that has worked in our interest. Second most important point that we need to note is that the world has changed over the years, and there is no longer a backyard. I say there is no longer a backyard because the South China Sea, the US moves around freely. Ukraine, you have the NATO forces there. Venezuela, Russia and China are there. You look at the Middle East or West Asia, as we call it, there's everyone there. I mean, and there's someone pulling out, someone else coming in. So there is no backyard as such. So you should remember that when people talk about or make a big deal about the Indian Ocean and China being there and somebody else being there and we safeguarding our own interests, remember there is no backyard. It's a free and open world. Anyone is free to go anywhere that they want. And that's why different people are in different places trying to safeguard their own interests. So that's why India's foreign policy, the main objective of India's foreign policy is India first. That is the most important thing, and that is what we always focus on, and that is what this government has been focusing on. When I say India first, I mean India first, and we owe security and ensuring that our borders are safe from both traditional and non-traditional forces. The world is changing. Like I said initially itself, you have new threats, you have new dimensions, you have single wolf attacks, you have terrorists who are taking new shape. So how do you protect against that? This is how you do it. You ensure that you keep Indian borders safe. The last time, when was the last big attack in India? When was the last big attack? Okay. Last big attack was 26/11. I say that not because of anything else. Yes, someone must be saying, oh, your bosha Yuri film nodilla anta. For the non-Kannada members in the audience here, basically it means inhone shayad Uri film nahi dekhi hai. Uri and Pulwama and all of those other attacks were on military bases. The last time civilians were really targeted was in 26/11. Post that, there has been no significant major attack on Indian soil. We are safe today only because of our policies. Second, RCEP. That again is India first. Why are we out of RCEP? If we had signed the RCEP deal, you are already crying about how Ganeshas are made in China, how your diyas, 2 rupee diyas are made in China, how your plastic toys are made in China. Imagine if we had signed the RCEP in its present form. What would you have done when China opened the floodgates? What would your businesses here have done? Secondly, our farmers, our dairy farmers, small, they produce what? They have 2 cows. Average size of an Indian dairy farmer is 2 cows. That's the average. Can he compete with a New Zealander or an Australian who has 2000 cows? And what do you do with all that dairy product that will come into India? This again is India first and ensuring that our interests are safeguarded. Second, you need to have, or the second main objective is to create an external environment which is conducive for internal growth. How does that happen? You give a fillip to your initiatives that have started, like Make in India, Digital India, Swachh Bharat, several. I mean, there are several, Startup India, there are so many. So how do you give a fillip? You improve the ease of doing business. You ensure that, you know, companies can come in. I'm not saying India is the best place to do business. We have several problems, but several measures have been taken, at least in the recent past, to try and get in more money from outside. So FDI is one way of ensuring that you have, you know, you improve the external environment so that you get more FDI from outside. It comes in and then your internal economy improves. Third objective of India's foreign policy is to ensure that India's voice is heard on the global level. That is being taken care of by the Prime Minister himself. He's spearheading his efforts. He has his personal contacts. He has his personal equations with everyone. you know, despite all the problems, despite China taking on India even at the UN up post August 5th, despite all those troubles you had, you still had the Chennai connect between Xi Jinping and Prime Minister Modi. So this is the kind of equations that we have. So to ensure that India's voice is heard globally, and also let's not forget, post August 5th, there have been only 3 countries that have come out openly and spoken against India's stand. There has been nobody else who has done it. One, of course, is China. China is mixed. I mean, once they say this, once they say that, but clearly they are against us. One is China. The other one is Malaysia. Yes. And correct. So these are the 3 nations, and we are dealing with these 3 nations separately also. For instance, there was a visit that was planned of Prime Minister Modi to Turkey in October, but that was cancelled because of Turkey's stand at the international forum. Also, what happened on the sidelines of the UNGA? Prime Minister Modi met with the leaders of Cyprus, Armenia, and also Greece. These 3 countries have major border issues or major territory issues, let's put it that way, with Turkey. This was one thing that was done. Third, what was done? I don't know how many of you know this, but India is a major supplier of explosives and explosive materials, the wires and whatever else that you get, detonators and all of that, to Turkey. So Turkey uses a lot of this in their mines and other things. So India has said, or several other people have said, that those detonators and explosives have been doing their rounds and coming back to Pakistan, and Pakistan has been using them, or there could be a major threat of Pakistan using them. But these explosives were definitely used in places like Syria and Iraq, where the ISIS is present. So through Turkey, these explosives have gone to these places. So the IEDs, basically. So that is another issue. So India is tackling Turkey in that way as well. India will take on Malaysia too. And of course, China is, we still don't have the capacity to take on China at the moment, but we will continue. For instance, China seems to be against us at every point. Yet we are at it, you know, we are trying to get into the nuclear suppliers group, you know, we are negotiating, we are trying desperately. Many of you may ask, what is it that you are going to achieve? Why do you want to get into the nuclear suppliers group? We know that is not going to happen. China is always going to say no. I'll give you a simple example. There's a tree here. Okay, now you have the jacksaw and all of that. You can swipe it off with one blade. But if there's a tree and you want to chop it down the old Indian way, you take an axe, you don't swipe it down with one blow. You keep chipping at it, chipping at it, chipping at it, and only then does it finally fall. So that's what our strategy is with China as well, and the NSG. So we keep bringing it up, we keep raising it, and we keep making a noise around it, so that one day eventually, you know, we make an entry and we get what we want. So that is also having basically a voice at the global stage. And of course, the fourth and most important is engaging with the Indian diaspora. Because what is the strength of the Indian diaspora, anyone? No. Strength of the Indian diaspora, Indian or people of Indian origin. You're right, roughly around 25 million. There's no real accurate measure, because you have different measures of what exactly that consists of, but roughly around 25 million. That's a huge population. You know, people who are in very good places abroad, who can make an influence who can be influencers really, and try to influence their governments in ensuring that they have some kind of a leaning towards India. So engaging with the Indian diaspora, keeping them safe, keeping them secure, and also ensuring that we can help them out in any way possible. So the former EM, Sushma Swaraj, did that very, very well. And she's still known, I mean, by several Indians. You speak to anyone who's been in trouble over the last 5 years, who's gone abroad, everyone just swears and takes the name of Sushma Swaraj because of the fine work that she has done. So that is something that, you know, not everyone can be a Sushma Swaraj. Let's not forget that as well. She was the first female chief minister of Delhi. She has also done so many other things. She's been in politics. She was in politics for over 40 years. Youngest female chief minister also, I think. Yeah. So, yeah. So, I mean, not everybody can match up with her caliber and her stature. But that doesn't mean that the good work that she has done or that she did for 5 years has been forgotten. India is still at it. Maybe you can't see it as much as you could when she was around. Like I said, not everybody can be a Sushma Swaraj. So these are the four objectives really as far as India's foreign policy is concerned. Let me now, any questions, anyone has any doubts, anything that you want to raise, anything? No? Okay, so can I move on? Alright, so it's a vast topic, India's foreign policy. So that's why I said I want to concentrate on one particular region, because we can go into that particular region and we can focus on that a little more and go a little in depth and not just have an overview as such, because I think you deserve more than just an overview, because an overview all of y'all can give me, I'm sure. But let's go a little in depth and understand West Asia as well. Traditionally, West Asia has not been a very pro, if you can have the map also please, Himanshu, if you can, has not been a very, everyone knows where West Asia is, right? Clear? What is West Asia popularly known as? So yeah, so this basically is, this portion here is basically West Asia. So yeah, so basically this is West Asia. So we call it, I find it a little odd. Okay, before I proceed, what is said here remains here, because I work for a parliamentary channel at the end of the day. I'm privy to a lot of information. I'm going to be as frank as I possibly can be. But I would appreciate it if you keep what is said in this room. If you want to put something out, we'll have a look at what needs to be put out. We can figure that out later and we'll do that. But no, I think this is good. So yeah, so strangely, we call it West Asia. We are probably the only ones who call it West Asia. But we don't have a West Asia division in the Ministry of External Affairs. We have a division everywhere else, but we have what is called as a, anyone? We don't have a Middle East division. Middle East is a US term. Sorry? We have Gulf, but Gulf is only your GCC countries. Anyone? You guys will be asked these questions. Come on. When you go for your interviews and all that. No one? Central Asia is here. Central Asia is here. This is Central Asia. And Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan and all of that. No? No one? It's called WANA. West Asia and Northern Africa. That is the division that deals with this. The Gulf, there's a Gulf division also, but that doesn't deal with the whole of West Asia. It only deals with the GCC countries. So here I'm going to focus only on West Asia. Okay, I'm going to talk about Iran also today if you guys want me to. But your WANA division doesn't have Iran in it. So there's another division called, where does Iran fall? Anyone? No? It's called PAI. Like your banker PAI. PAI. It's, anyway, so what are those three? There are three countries in PAI. What are the three countries? Correct. So it's Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Iran. So this is, and then you have a Central Asia division as well that deals with all these other countries. So I'm going to focus on West Asia today. So traditionally, this particular bloc has not really been very pro-India. It's obviously, because of obvious reasons. I mean, They're all Muslim countries, you know, they've been closer to Pakistan historically. They have had family ties with Pakistan. For instance, one of the royals from Jordan was married to a Pakistani. So they obviously have those strong, you know, family ties and the religious ties and all of that. So this has been a real big success story as far as Prime Minister Modi's foreign policy is concerned, because over the last 6 years, we've been able to turn all of this around. The entire region is now pro-India. The UAE, Saudi Arabia, were one of the first, UAE was in fact one of the first country that came out in support post August 5th. It came out in support of India directly. Now that is something that is, it's a little difficult to have fathomed maybe 10 years ago, because the military of Saudi Arabia, the police of UAE, were all being trained by Pakistanis. So Pakistani military actually used to go and train them. Now, of course, we are getting into an agreement. I think the agreement has already been signed with Saudi Arabia, where we will be training the Saudi army and so on and so forth. So all this has changed over the last 6 years. It was not this way maybe about 10 years ago or 15 years ago. So, you know, and the strange thing is, despite all these countries, it's a very volatile and a very fragile region, because they are constantly, you know, fighting and squabbling with each other. There have been no wars, but the region is always in a state of war. You know, the Qataris have a problem with Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, UAE and the others are one block. You know, Qataris are trying to get close to Iran and so on and so forth. Iran and Saudi Arabia are dead enemies, because Iran is a Shia country. Saudi Arabia is a Sunni country, so they have their own traditional problems. Then, of course, you have Israel here, which probably has a mind better than Trump's, the Israelis. So Israel has its own issue as well, but I must say they've done significantly well. But despite all these challenges, despite all these problems, despite this one not talking to this one, that one not talking to this one, I mean, and all of that happening, despite a lot of tutu meme, India has very strong relations with everyone in this region. And what has happened is, we have de-hyphenated all our relationships with these countries here. It was probably for the first time when Prime Minister Modi visited Israel, the joint statement had the name of Palestine on it. Palestine and Israel do not gel at all. The Israelis will not even sit on a panel. Forget about sit on a panel. They won't even lend their voice to a program that is done in India if they know that the Palestinian ambassador is part of that program or has said something there. So that is the level of animosity. They don't even accept that Palestine exists. So it was for the first time that a joint statement from, you know, Israel had the name of Palestine on it. So that is what India has been able to do. By the way, your map is wrong. So yeah, so that's what it is. So now we have West Asia as well. So I mean Northern Africa as well. So that's good. So yeah, so Saudi Arabia is looking to invest. Let's start with Saudi Arabia, since it's the biggest country in West Asia. Saudi Arabia is looking to invest heavily in India, looking heavily to invest in China. It's looking east after having looked west for several decades, you know, sending everyone from their royal family, sending their citizens to be educated in the US. Now they are slowly shedding that and they are coming closer towards India and China. Let's focus on India for now. Let's not think about China. Why do you think that's happening? Anyone? Yeah, why are they changing their policy? They are diversifying, definitely, yes. But then they are anyways getting income from here. We've been giving them income for decades together. Okay, I'll take that. Yeah, then? Yeah, so, yeah, they're all right. But, definitely, yes. But it was always an emerging market for them. I mean, we are the biggest market for the China and India put together are the biggest market for these guys. In UAE, definitely yes, because we are at the high table at the in the UAE. In Saudi, it's a little Indians just go there to do labor. But they are enemies, so it's good for them. So I'll tell you what. So they have invested so heavily in the West. You know, they have done so much for them. They believe that the West is not reciprocating, is not giving them back enough. For instance, the murder of the assassination of Jamal Khashoggi, they did not expect that kind of a backlash. You know, the company started withdrawing because of Congress pressure and because of pressure from other, you know, high and mighty people in the US. Several companies started withdrawing, pulling out of Saudi Arabia. You know, all these things happened. So, and another reason, see, they were very close to Pakistan as well, like I said, because of the historical linkages. But even from Pakistan now, they are keeping away. Of course, when Pakistan, when Imran Khan went to them with a begging bowl, they had to eventually give him something because of their historical linkages or whatever. But they're trying to stay, they're trying to keep away from Pakistan. Anyone? Any guesses? Sorry? Stand up and speak loudly, please. They can't hear you. Correct. You're right. That is the reason. So when Saudi and Yemen, of course, someone was talking about the oil supplies being hit and the projectiles being sent from Yemen and all of that, all those problems. So Saudi Arabia wanted to get rid of Yemen completely and annihilate them. And they at that point in time were going through a bad phase also because the oil markets were not really doing too well. Oil was, you know, languishing somewhere at $40 a barrel. So they had a problem. So they went to Pakistan. Because Pakistan at the end of the day has a decent army. So they went to Pakistan and they said, we need your support. We've been supporting you for so many years. Give us your support. We want to go to war with Yemen. Pakistan flatly refused. Pakistan said, nothing doing. We don't want to participate in your war. So that is something that upset the Saudis. So that's why now they realize India could be a better partner, India needs to be engaged with, and that's why they have started looking towards this side and looking towards the East and want to do business with us. And also, yes, like several of you rightly pointed out, you're looking at climate change, you're looking at cleaner fuel, you're looking at, you know, better ways to save and preserve the world. So generally, there's this whole debate and this discussion about how we need to move towards cleaner fuel and do something to change the environment and to reverse climate change. I don't know if that can happen because the damage, I believe, has already been done. We are already too late now. But so that's why they want to ensure that they diversify. They will get into other aspects. They do other things because they too need to live at the end of the day because oil is also eventually going to run out for them. So they need to, they are thinking ahead. They are looking ahead. And let's not forget, we may not be very rich or the per capita income here in India, we may not have money in our pockets, but as a block, as a collective, we are very strong. There's a massive demand in India, there's massive consumption that takes place here. So everybody wants a piece of the pie, everybody wants to come to India to be a part of this particular market so that they can tap into it and they can get rich or they can get their pennies also. So that's what's happening as far as Saudi Arabia is concerned. Any questions on Saudi Arabia? No? All clear? I think I'll stop in 15 minutes. I'll take a breather because I'll have a glass of water and I will also just stroll around and I'll give you 5 minutes. Those who have not gone through the passage quickly can go through the passage. I want two things out of it. One, who is the hero of the story? Think out of the box, okay? This is not traditional Mahabharata or traditional story of Eklavya and Dronacharya and all of that. Think a little out of the box. I want to get who the hero is from a foreign policy perspective, and also there's a diplomatic message in that. I want the diplomatic message. All right, in the next 15 minutes. Okay, so you don't have to look at it now. I'll give you 5 minutes. You can look at it later. No questions on Saudi Arabia, right? So this has been a major victory for us. Another major victory has been Jordan. You know, Jordan has had, like I said, familial ties with Pakistan. They've had the royal was married to a Pakistani. Despite that, India has turned it around now, and we are doing excellently well with Jordan. Why is Jordan important for us? Jordan is important for us because of its strategic location, it's strategically placed here. So that is very, very important. Also, most of our raw material that we use in our fertilizers comes from Jordan, phosphate and so on and so forth. So that's why Jordan is important to us. And Jordan, there has been a significant turnaround. Please pull out the map. I want to look at Iran. So this is Iran. Like I said, I'll speak about a little bit about Iran as well before I go to Iran's nemesis, Israel. So off late, because of the US sanctions and all that, our ties with Iran are on hold. They're not bad. They are in no doubt they are in no way bad, because the Prime Minister met Hassan Rouhani just recently. The Foreign Secretary was there. The Foreign Minister has met a delegation from Iran. So the ties are in a decent place. But both India and Iran realize that it's foolish to take on America at this point in time, because it's uncalled for and it's not needed. So they are hoping for better times. They are hoping that we could possibly get a waiver later on or something like that to continue our relations, because we've had cultural linkages with Iran. We've had very warm ties with them from the beginning, and you know that has already always worked in our favor. So why is Iran important? So right now our port is in Bandar Abbas, right? So it goes to Bandar Abbas, it then goes up here. There's a road link that takes it up here, and then it goes here. It goes into this area, and then Caspian Sea basically, and then it goes into Russia and it goes into Central Europe. So that's the current route right now. It's a long route that goes like that. Why is Chabahar important? It is closer. So you, from your Gujarat port, you don't have to go all the way till there. From here, you just have to go till here. And you go up and it goes into Afghanistan. And then it goes up and it goes into Turkmenistan and other places. The problem, and this is basically your north-south corridor, what you call your north-south corridor, connecting the south to the north. Alright. The problem with this particular project is that it's almost finished. Everything is in place. Chabahar is functional at the moment. The only issue is there's a small little rail link here of about 200 kilometers. That is not completed because of various reasons. Because it's somewhere over here, so there's a problem that is arising between Turkmenistan and the other countries and all of that. And that particular rail link of about 200 kilometers is not completed right now. Once that rail link is completed, this access becomes fully clear. You can either go here and take the land route into all these other places, into Central Asia, into Afghanistan and all that. Or you could either go to the sea and use the sea route, come back to land here and then go to wherever you want to go to. So that's why Iran is very, very important, and Iran has always been supportive of India whenever it comes to its policies and other aspects. That is Iran. Now let's talk about, you want me to talk about Afghanistan or no? Are you interested in Afghanistan? Okay, not part of West Asia, but okay, since I'm here at Iran, I'll talk about Afghanistan as well. You know, for long, India has, or the world has been asking India to play a bigger role in Afghanistan. But what can that bigger role be is the real question. Do we want to send our soldiers from here to Afghanistan and fight their war? I don't think that's the answer, because the Americans have done it. They have tried it for almost 2 decades now. And when the Americans have not been able to be successful with all their money, with all their technology and with everything else, why should we go and get our hands dirty in a business that does not concern us at the end of the day? Right? So Afghanistan So in the process, what has happened is that India has been kept out of the negotiations, you know, because we've not been, because there are bigger players there. There's Russia, there's China, there's the US. So everybody wants to, has their own agenda, has their own issues that they want to sort out here. And let's not forget the role of Pakistan. Pakistan is trying desperately to keep India out because Pakistan does not want India to have any role in Afghanistan. Now, these countries, the US, Russia and others, need Pakistan because of their proximity to Afghanistan. Without Pakistan, it's certainly impossible to deal with what's happening in Afghanistan, because it's the Pashtuns and the others who are here in Pakistan who know this terrain also. They are the ones who know how to go in here and do whatever they have to do at the end of the day, enter the caves and what not. But Pakistan does not want India to get involved. But India is involved on the ground. You know, Trump may call it whatever he wants to call it, but at the end of the day, there is tremendous goodwill for the people of India from Afghanistan because of the kind of work that we've done there. We've opened hospitals, we've given them aid, cultural centers, you know, a gamut of things that we've done in Afghanistan that has really helped the people, and they have seen visible change. They have seen it for themselves. So even if there is a change in regime, if the Taliban comes to power at some point in time or whatever happens, let's wait and watch and see what happens here. Whatever happens here, the people have seen what India have given them on the ground. So the people will expect the same and will want that. So many people may say, okay, India has failed in Afghanistan, India has not done well in Afghanistan. I would like to remind them about what happened in Maldives. Right now, nobody is talking about the Maldives. 1 year ago, everyone had a problem with what India was doing. A year and a half ago, some people were saying India should send ships to Maldives, India should send its army into Maldives. We do not want to have a pro-China government in the Maldives. Look at what's happening in the Maldives. But look at what's happening today. We're sitting in a pretty place. We are happy with what's happening in the Maldives. Same thing since we are here. Same thing in Syria. India has always maintained and supported Bashar al-Assad right from the beginning in Syria. Now you have Trump pulling out. You have the Russians reinforcing themselves. You have Turkey trying to get in and, you know, sort out the issue with the Kurds. So the Kurd situation is very sad. If you want me to explain about the Kurds also. Kurds basically are a landless people. They have no land. And they have no identity. Identity as in no state identity. So they are stateless. So they are all here now. They are not on the border. They are on the border, but they are just below the border. So there is Islamic State in between. So the Islamic State is the buffer. So you have the Islamic State here, you have the Kurds here, and you have Turkey here. And these Kurds are also largely populated in Turkey, and that's why the Turks want to take them out, because they don't want to have any problems with the Kurds at some point in time, because of the internal problems that they have there. So now to get to the Kurds, they have to go through Islamic State first. So Turkey is also stuck in a difficult situation. Anyway, so Trump has gone out, or is planning to eventually get out of here. So who's going to come back to power, or who's going to take control at the end of the day? Bashar al-Assad, someone who we've been supporting right from the beginning. So call it luck, call it whatever it is. But these things have worked for us. I'm sure it is well calculated. Then, you know, the people at the highest level are looking into all of these things and only then taking these decisions. I was in Afghanistan, right? Yeah, so there's tremendous goodwill as far as the people are concerned. So Afghanistanis will want that eventually. So that's what's working in our favor. And we've made the right decision in Afghanistan as well. At least I strongly believe, because there's nothing more that we could have possibly done than it is a foolish move to send our people into Afghanistan at this juncture. Have I left out anything? There's UAE. I'll come to UAE. Turkey, I mentioned in the beginning. I'll come to Turkey as well. Water break for now, 5 minutes. And you can have a look at the two images and we'll continue. Alright, so, okay, map please. Is it better with the map or without the map? Okay, with the map. By the way, this is Eritrea. Just for your knowledge, I don't know how many of you know it, but make a note of it. In the next couple of decades, it's going to be the next Dubai. Because There are several problems in this region. There are several problems here because of the missiles and all of those issues with this particular channel in the Red Sea that goes up here. This is how the trade goes, huh, by the way. So if it's going from this side of the world, it goes this way, it goes here, it goes here, it goes here, and that's how it reaches Europe. Alright. So right now all the trade channels are this side, closer towards Saudi Arabia. That's the route that is used because most of the ports and all of that are on this side. But here, because of all the problems that these guys have, Sudan has its own problem with South Sudan and Sudan, they are fighting always. Israel has their own problems with, homegrown terrorism and all of that. So, Eritrea, Ethiopia is pretty much safe. Somalia has its issues, but Ethiopia and Djibouti work as buffers. Djibouti is here, Ethiopia is here. This is the Horn of Africa, if you want to know better. So, this little tiny space is called Eritrea. That's going to be the next big trading hub, just like your Singapore and Dubai and all of that, because they want to move out of the conflict of this area and move there. Oh, okay. Great job. Map has changed. You guys are fast, I must say. Okay. So, shall we talk about Israel? We've not spoken about Israel, right? So, traditionally, the Israelis have always been close to India. There is absolutely no doubt about that. But India, because of the sizable Muslim population in the country, have not been openly in support of Israel, because they believe that if they openly supported Israel, then the Muslim population in the country would be upset with the present government in the country and may not vote for them in the next elections. So that's why overtly we've never been in support of Israel, but Israel has always had a soft corner towards India. If you go to Israel, if any of you at any point in time go to Israel and you say you're Indian, they will welcome you, they will take you into their house, they will ensure that you have a meal, they will ensure that they do everything for you and then send you out. Many of them speak Hindi, many of them are fluent in Sanskrit. That's the kind of engagement and cultural connect that they have with India. Most of the Israelis have to do a stint in the army compulsorily, all Israelis. So either before they go and join the army or after they finish, they come to Himachal, they go to Dharamshala, they go to Manali, they go to the other places, and I'm not going to spell out what they do there. You guys seem to know what they do there, so. Yeah, McLeodgunj, and but they are fantastic people, huh? If you interact with them, if you talk to them, very jovial, very happy and nice people. So traditionally we've had good ties with Israel. What has happened in the last 6 years is that we've embraced it and we have said that yes, we are engaging with Israel. But we have not, at the same time, we haven't forgotten our friends in Palestine as well. We have engaged with them also, but usually every time that there has been a visit, highest level had not happened till Prime Minister had gone for a long, long time. But every time there was a visit, it was always hyphenated. In the sense, you go to Israel and compulsorily you will go to Palestine as well. So that's how it was. But this was the first time in history where Prime Minister Modi travelled separately to Israel and travelled separately to Palestine. That has never happened before. And by the way, So state visits to Israel and Palestine were done separately. So that was the first time that it ever happened. So this is where the concerned areas are. This is where the concerned issues are. When the US took a unilateral decision about Jerusalem also, India, all eyes were on India to see what India would say and what India would do. But India did not support the US. India did not support Israel. We said that our stand as far as this particular issue is concerned is neutral. We don't like to comment. We don't like to engage on this particular subject. And it has been a success story really. And by the way, the visit of Prime Minister Modi to Palestine was officially communicated for the first time on my show, The Big Picture, by the Palestinian ambassador who gave us the news that Prime Minister Modi would be visiting Palestine. So the Palestinians also are happy with us. We have to continue to engage with Palestine again because of the Muslim population that we have in the country. Nobody wants to antagonize that part of the society, or that, because at the end of the day we are all Indians. So that's something that every establishment needs to understand and needs to go forward. So Israel and us are engaging on several matters and several aspects, be it agriculture. We are trying to learn about their models of agriculture, because if you see Israel, none of the other countries have been able to replicate what Israel has done. Israel is a desert, basically. There's nothing there. There's only rock and soil. There's absolute rock and it's not even soil. Soil is something that you can grow on. It's just dust and rock. But they have transformed that little country in all but 60 years into a paradise. They are self-sufficient. They are influencing world policy through the Israeli diaspora that they have in the US and everywhere else. They engage with their people. They always want to get back to their people. They always want to, you know, the Israeli have the best spies in the world. They are all over the place and nobody even knows that they are there. So that's how integrated they are, and that's how well connected they are. So we are coordinating with them on agriculture. There's some high-end technology as well that we are collaborating with them on. There's also defense equipment that we are collaborating with them on. And it's a wide area. Of course, there's a lot of scope as far as the relationship is concerned. There's far more to do. But that's where it stands right now. And we are looking to engage them further. And they are also looking to engage us further. And I told you about the dehyphenation and everything as far as Israel and Palestine is concerned. Now, let's focus on, okay, just a quick question. How many Indians are there in this region? About 12 to 13 million people there. That is huge. And all of the money that is made here, see, in the US, it's different. The money that is made there is spent there. Nothing comes back. All the money that is made here comes back here. And that is why this region is so very important for us. Why else is this region important for us? Energy security. Because India first again, we need to secure our energy needs. That's why this particular region is extremely, extremely important for us. The highest number of Indians are in which place? UAE. So the highest number of Indians are in UAE, and they are at some of the best positions in the UAE, and that's why they've been able to collaborate. They've been able to engage with India the way that they have. Do you know Hindi is it's not third language; it's an official language. If you are brown skinned, they don't care. The Arabs will speak to you. If you ever visit Dubai and you take your passport to the immigration guy who's sitting there, an Arab, a UAE national, an Arab, you take your passport to him, he'll say, "Kaise ho?" The first thing he says is, "Kaise ho?" So they speak to you, the moment they see an Indian passport, they speak to you in Hindi. And it's not just them, the police and everybody else speaks in Hindi. Hindi is an official language. Hindi is a more spoken language than even Arabic in the UAE. And now I'll come to the third language. What is the third language? Malayalam. Malayalam is the third language. So Malayalam is also extensively spoken, and I think it's an acknowledged official language also in the UAE, Malayalam. The UAE is also important to us. UAE, a lot of our oil comes from the UAE. Dubai has no oil, but the oil comes from Abu Dhabi. So there are seven emirates in the UAE, Abu Dhabi being the capital, main place, basically. Not capital, but you know, main place. So the ruler of Abu Dhabi, or the king of Abu Dhabi, is the head of state, is the president of sorts, and the prime minister will be from Dubai. That's how their arrangement is, and that's how it works there. So they have strong connects with India and UAE. That is UAE. Have I missed out anything? Oh, by the way, why is Iraq important? Anyone? Who is the largest supplier of oil to India? Iraq is the largest supplier of oil to India. So, most of our, about 20% of our, 20 to 22% of our oil supply comes from Iraq. And that's why it is important. And also, Iraq and Iran, the refineries that we have here are best suited to use the oil of these two countries. So, if we use oil of any of the other countries, about 8 to 9% gets wasted. Because our refineries cannot refine that oil as well as we can refine the oil from Iraq and Iran. That is the story as far as West Asia is concerned. Any questions? Lot of questions upstairs, I must say. Seem to be far more energetic, I think, because I'm not amongst them. They seem to be discussing with each other and keeping their questions ready. Anyone? Any questions? Oh yeah, I'll come back to the story. Yes. Stand up and speak loudly so that I can hear you. Don't worry, you're not being judged.
Sir, you briefly talked about India's foreign policy, that India's national interest is above every interest as of now. So, and you already talked about Iran and Saudi Arabia, where India is having good relations with both the countries. And Saudi Arabia, after this whatever oil attack happened, said that we want to have a good relations with Iran, and they asked Pakistan to mediate between these two. So Imran Khan also visited Iran and then came to Saudi Arabia, right? So India has a greater stakes in this region, be it Chabahar port or Indian diaspora, oil security, energy security and stuff. And we have good relations with both the nations, Saudi Arabia and Iran. So what role can India play in mediating between both two and creating a regional balance between them?
I don't think India wants to get into the mediating role. Because if we get into mediating with other countries will want to jump and mediate in our matters. So that's why India has tried to stay clear, because the moment we say, okay, we will do some, that's why you have people like Rishi Ravi Shankar and all that going and mediating in Venezuela and South America and everywhere else. The government does not partake in any of this, because the moment you get involved and you say that I'll get involved, others will say, why don't we get involved in your issue?
Right.
And that is of paramount importance to us. That is something that we don't want to do at all.
So, mediating role is never taken by India in any places?
Usually not, unless they come and ask us and say, please mediate for us and all of that. India does not want to go and mediate and does not want to partake in any of these mediation, at least not openly.
At least not.
Yeah. No, we should not. Why? Why will we? It's our matter. It's our personal matter. It's our problem. Why should we allow anybody else to interfere? Then tomorrow they'll say, okay, you give away a little bit of your northeast also. I think China wants it too. That is not acceptable to us at all. And we should not. That is, I mean, whatever happens, we should not. Yes, anyone else?
So, as far as Iran is concerned, what should be India's move? Like, should it go what US has said, or should it act independently?
Act independently in Iran? We are already acting independently in Iran. I mean, this is just tokenism as far as the US is concerned, because Trump is a little dicey. So we're just keeping him happy for the time being. Elections are coming around the corner in the US as well. Both India and Iran have very good cultural and historical linkages. We are just playing the wait and watch game. Wait and see what happens, because there's a lot at stake for both India and for Iran. So we'll wait it out and then hope for better times.
So you're saying for time being,
for the time being, it's just going to be like this. I'll come to you. I've already answered two of your questions. Yes. They are maintaining friendly relations, but we are maintaining very strong relations also. In NAM, it was just, I'm staying away, boss. I don't want to have anything to do with this. Basically, that was it. But here, we have very strong bilateral linkages. We are engaging with all of these people bilaterally. At some point in time, though, we'll have to take a stand. At some point in time, there may be a situation where we have to take a stand. It's going to be challenging for our diplomats going forward. But let's see, we'll cross the bridge when we get there. But for now, we are maintaining very, very strong bilateral relations with all these countries. Have you ever seen any of our people visiting Eswatini? Do you even know what Eswatini is? We visited Eswatini. We are visiting Comoros. You know where Comoros is? So, I mean, have we ever visited these places? But we are visiting because we want to engage. We want to engage, and it's important to engage with all these countries. Anyone else? Where? It's because they will get involved in our issue, no? If we say we'll mediate. No, but we have bilateral relations. So, we are getting what we want from each of these countries individually any which ways. We are not suffering in any way. We are not being affected in any way. You are still getting fuel to fill in your bike, no? That is not stopped. So, it's the same way. Yes. Revolution. That's true. It has been a difficult place to deal with, and but those are the realities. Now, tomorrow the Americans say we want to go out, and Trump has promised his constituents. It's all politics at the end of the day. Don't forget that Trump has promised his people there that I am going to bring all our people back home. Elections are around the corner. Americans will not go out. Okay, it's as simple as that. They can't. After all the mess that they have created, they can't really go out. But he has to make these statements because the elections are around the corner. Every country has these problems, not just India. Yes, next please, anyone? Yeah.
On Kashmir issue.
I'll come to Kashmir. I'll talk about 370. Okay. I'll come to Kashmir. I'll come to
Kashmir. Sir, last one.
Yeah. Sir. Where?
Here.
No, not last. You can ask, no problem. I have time. But I told him last question.
Hello. First of all, sir, thank you very much for being here. Really, you know, you are our role model in the.
You voted for me or against me?
Yeah. Voted for you. So you. The thing is that, I mean, always we are entangled with RSTV debates and these things, and you know, for some people, cricketers, politicians, and big heroes are there. For us, from bottom of my heart, I'm saying you are the big hero for us. Okay. So, and my question is that, you know, the kind of diplomacy Modi is doing on. So, the first is that India has less money, not like that US and China. True. Okay. So, and we have only one thing, that is soft power. Okay. So, through that, how can we explore the kind of relations that we are expected to be, and you know. So, can we explore some kind of soft power we can proliferate in these Middle East regions, like that movies and these things in Kazakhstan, Afghanistan.
You are only answering your question.
No. So, explore some more things that actually you mentioned, that UAE and Eritrea and these things. If you know, have some more idea,
so,
please explore.
So, yoga, we already have the World Yoga Day. Bollywood is you know, we're promoting Bollywood in a big way. Cultural activities. We have this center called ICCR, you know, which is headed by Vinay Sastrabuddhe, who is the BJP MP, and he is also General Secretary or Vice President? Vice President BJP. And that is also, and an ambassador is, former ambassador to Maldives is someone who is heading the operational aspects of it. So, culturally also, we are engaging big time with like-minded people, with like-minded countries. There's a lot of cultural exchanges that happens. So, like you said, like you rightly pointed out, we don't have the deep pockets. Why do you think we have not sent anyone to Afghanistan? Not because we can't send. We don't have the money to send. I mean, even if we have the money to send, we don't have the money to spend like the Americans and to sustain a warfare like that. So that and also, why haven't we focused on this region the way we should we should traditionally be focusing? Because the Chinese are coming here. Why aren't we going here? Because we can't afford to take on the Chinese at this point in time. If we want to be a $5 trillion economy by 2024, do the math. At 5% growth, can we reach 5 trillion by 2024? How do we achieve this growth? Not with conflict, not with trying to, you know, mess around here and all of that. We keep our borders safe. Again, objectives: create an external environment. What is the size of our GDP? 2.8. Okay, how do we get to 5? Do you know 50% of our GDP is trade? 50% of our GDP is trade. So we have to ensure that we, because domestic consumption we've almost maxed. Everybody has a smartphone now, everybody has everything else. So domestic consumption is not going to pick up that significantly. The only way that we can grow at that rate, or we can, so to reach 5 trillion, we need to grow at 10% in some quarters and then consistently at 8% by 2024, because we've already had two bad quarters or three bad quarters. So the only way we do that is to increase trade. Soft power, like you said, we are doing it. It's not like we're not doing Bollywood, yoga and other things. The only thing is we need to stay away from conflict and ensure that we maximize whatever we can. That's why Prime Minister Modi is going everywhere by himself, to have that strong top level connect. The problem is future use. I mean, you all are going to be there in that position soon. You all don't follow up on any of this. Everybody is simply sitting quietly on file or on the phone. Nobody is following up. The Prime Minister is doing his job. But who's actually following up? That's the problem. That's what we need to change. The biggest criticism as far as India is concerned is projects and tie-ups and all of that are announced, are spoken about, but the implementation is nil. Nothing is really happening. But I must say, in the last few years, we have done tremendously well. Very recently here, we've delivered 44,000 houses to the people of Sri Lanka. And it has been done, the project has been completed in less than 2.5 years. Never happened before. So it's changing. Let's hope that it changes faster. That's why I say, and that's why I always oblige and come and talk to UPSC aspirants. Because you guys, you know, we can sit and complain very happily. Are main desh ko chhod ke chala jaunga, na nirala paile. Takaito. Everybody wants to go to the US. What are you going to get in the US? After 5 years, after 7 years, you may get citizenship, but you'll always be treated as dirt. You're an unwanted person in the United States. You will be treated as a third grade citizen, whether you like it or not. So would you rather be here and be treated as a human being, or go to the US, have money in your pocket and be treated as a third grade citizen? You guys need to get into the system and be the change. The country depends on you. The country needs you. If you don't do it, who will do it? It's very easy to complain. I could have gone with my name. Do you think any of the Western countries would have rejected me? I'm here for a reason. If some of my elders would have told me about UPSC and told me about how to do it, I would have put my mind and soul behind it and done it. I didn't have anybody to tell me. Today you have people like Vinay and others who are telling you or coaching you. Make use of that opportunity. Go ahead. You guys are in a great place. You guys are being shown the way forward by a great person. Please ensure that you do something, be the change, and make this country better. One person can't do it. Everybody has to do it collectively, responsibly. Yes, any more questions? Sorry, I got carried away, emotional.
Hello. Hello, sir. How can we reconcile with the fact that geopolitics and trade has been being hard on India's ideological stance? For example, Saudi Arabia and Turkey, Syria are the leading human rights violators. As you said, we have been supporting Syria. US entered Syria because it bombed its own citizens with chemical weapons. In such a situation, are we compromising on our ideological...
Do you think US is even bothered about what's happening in Syria and Iraq?
At least on the outset of it.
That they will do. The Americans are very famous for that, giving it a spin. They are interested only in the oil. They are not interested in anything else.
But are we also moving in that direction?
No, see, I'll tell you something. How can we not get oil from them? If you don't get oil from them, where do we get oil from?
Okay, sir. We'll get oil from there and...
Tomorrow, if you need your Ola, Uber, if you need your bike and everything to move, we need their oil. So, how... this? At the same time, the Europeans are saying, or the UNHRC is saying, that we have committed gross atrocities here, major human rights violations. This kind of posturing always happens. It's nothing but political. We need to ensure that our own interests are safeguarded. These people are important to us. These people are important to us because their oil comes from.
So it's economy or ideology?
Economy or ideology?
Or ideology.
That's true. Economy always is first. Anyone else? That's not going to happen. Simple. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 of us are here sitting down. We are making all decisions. All decisions that concern everything. Okay. Why will I want you to come here? This is my exclusive right. My exclusive place. I might make a noise for making a noise. No, we need reforms. We need this. We need that. Very good. Reforms is good. World has changed and all that. But why will I want you to come here? That reduces my hold, no? That will never happen. No, that we have to do. I didn't say that we shouldn't do it. We should keep at it. Eventually, hopefully it will, not till I'm alive, I don't think it will happen. But we keep chipping. It's like how the water turns stone into sand. Yes. We are definitely trying to make our own place in the world, and people have also realized that and given us our place in the world. You know, a few years ago, nobody even took us seriously. Who even cared about what's happening in India or what's not happening in India? But now people care. People take notice. People want to meet the Prime Minister. People want to engage with India. Everybody is coming to India. We are going everywhere. So definitely it's changing. But also, let's not forget one thing. In all of this, we are not forgetting any of our old friends, huh? We are taking everyone along. We have a strong relationship with Bangladesh. We have a strong relationship with Bhutan. We have a strong relationship with Myanmar. In Bhutan, when the elections happened recently, there was a untested, unknown pro-China entity that won the elections. But despite that, we have very, very strong relations with Bhutan because we have linkages with the royal family. So we are not forgetting these people. We are not forgetting these people. We are not forgetting Sri Lanka. We are not forgetting Maldives. We're not forgetting everyone. I mean, we are definitely progressing, but we are taking others along as well. The others, of course, have their issues, but everyone is coming around because they know that the Chinese model is not something that is going to work for them in the long run. Everyone has realized that and understood that. So that's something that is there. No. That is the most important issue.
So don't you think that India should be engaging with China in trying to have a way around CPEC in the BRI project?
No, we are engaging with China any which ways. The Indian market is huge. China needs us. It's not like, you know, China doesn't want the Indian market. So whatever is happening on that front is happening. But we are also putting up a strong stand because we cannot be pushovers anymore. And China needs us, we need China at the end of the day.
So if India is no longer a part of RCEP, it's not even engaging in BRI, so won't India be a little behind the world with respect to the 5 trillion target?
So I'll tell you what's happening. India is out of RCEP. Okay. World map, please. But We have now started engaging, and a project that was dead for almost a decade is being reignited. We are trying to get our FTA with Europe. Talks have begun. You know, it's a little silly, I find it. Okay? Because, you know where the talks are stuck? Does anyone know where the FTA talks with Europe are stuck? No. Broad perspective. Anyone? So, India wants goods and services. They are saying no to that. Because they want only goods, they don't want services. Because services means India will go, Indians will go there. That is something that they are concerned about. They don't want that. Not like we go and do anything there. They take in, these refugees by the millions to create ruckus in Germany and all of that. That is fine. But Indians who want to go and work is not fine. So, that is a little, so we want goods and services. They want only goods. Another issue, the French are very picky and, you know, very, very emotional they get when you talk about their wine. So they are saying they want their wine to come to India. We are saying no, where will our wine growers grow if your wine comes, nobody will really buy our wine. So, but then wine is nothing, it's hardly any industry, it's hardly anything. So, they can give them some sops or something like that, give France their wine. Anyways, Delhi is the largest consumer of French wine. So, give them their wine, they'll also be happy, we'll also be happy. And third issue is of course with Germany, they want automobiles. We are saying no to their automobiles. I don't understand what's the problem there also, because they'll come with their Mercedes, with their BMW and everything else. How does it matter? How many of us are going to buy those? You want to export, export, boss. We'll buy 100 in a year, go. So, this is where it is stuck. So, they are reviving that. I'm very hopeful that it will go through, because it is in Europe's interest also and it's in India's interest, because Europe is our largest trading bloc. So, this is a very, very important market for us, and this is an important market for them also. So, it has, for instance, you know, what Bangladesh has done, very smartly done. They have said, we are a poor country, we are this, we are that. They have had an FTA with them. Their products are going at, just rough figure, I don't know the exact figures, about 5-6%. Their clothes and all that. Whereas us, we don't have an FTA with them. We don't have anything with them. It's going at 14-15%. Obviously, the Bangladeshi products, which are almost similar to ours, will be preferred over Indian products. So, sign the goddamn FTA, get it done with, and we are also proof. Anyone else?
So, I remember this from your show, The Big Picture.
Yeah.
One of your panelists quoted Dr. Manmohan Singh, and right. He stated, if India grows at 12% per annum, UN will invite us for the permanent membership. So, do you think economy is the path ahead? Is it a possibility to get into that high table if we choose the path of economy?
Absolutely. Economy is everything. Everybody is only concerned about money and nothing else. The economy is the biggest driver for anything and everything. If you have the money, throw, like what do the Gulf nations have at the end of the day? They only have money, nothing else. What are the Chinese doing right now? They're going to Africa, they're going to South America, they're going to, now Italy has decided to join their BRI with conditions. So, they're going to Europe and all over the place. All they have is money. So, if we have the money and the goodwill and the cultural and historical ties, imagine what we can do. Yes, anyone else?
So, from the energy security perspective, we are engaging in we are focusing on the renewable energy sources such as international solar lands and everything. That being said, for the current scenario, the oil and the coal are the primary drivers of energy. And in order to avoid any fluctuations of those supply, we have diversified our energy basket also. At that being said, the second point is we are engaging also with the world economies to a greater extent. And especially in the Central Asia from the energy perspective also. And with the recent engagement with the world economies, there is a close relations between America and India, be it the Comcast, Katsa, Lima, everything. However, when it comes to the energy security, because of the US sanctions, we have reduced the oil imports from Iran to more than 50%. Mm.
which is
complete,
one of,
Iran is completely stopped.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, sir. So how do we see that as an India first policy, or do you see that India as a puppet in the hands of the Western countries?
Not really puppet in the hand of the Western countries, but we have to be wary at the end of the day. You know, like I said, we are dealing with a wacko. So we need to massage his ego. We need to, you know, see what we did very, very well, and what I think was a masterstroke as far as we've done several things. So Trump's soft corner is Ivanka Trump. So when she came to India in Hyderabad, lot of people raised questions. Lot of people said, you know, who is she? She is not. She doesn't have any position. Why are we doing so much for her? Why are we doing this? Why are we doing? Because we rolled out the red carpet and how? But he reciprocated. When we went to the US, he saw that, he gave us the same. So it's all a show. It's all theatrics. You have to do this. And so we are not bending over, because if you see, we still have our bilateral relations with all these other countries as well. The president is going, the vice president is going, the prime minister is going, now the foreign minister is also going. So we are trying to engage at every level. See, everywhere you will have issues. There's absolute, you cannot have, if there is no issues, then there's no relationship.
Well, I have a supplementary question, sir. With regard to US sanctions, the sanctions were imposed despite the International Atomic Energy Agency giving a clean sheet for the Iran. And when the US imposed sanctions, the rest of the countries follows its cues. Do you think USA has a world of its own, or a country?
The president is in a world of his own. So he does these things. So, but then, you know, if you look, like I said, if you analyze and you watch Trump carefully, there's some method to his madness. And now I think the world has also realized, you know, he raises the stakes so high. He's like a poker player. He raises the stakes so high, and then finally he'll come down, he'll act like, you know, the magnanimous person, and okay, I've given you. Go. Bakshish, lelo. So that's how it is with Trump. So they've realized it. So that's what it is. Anyone? Yes.
With respect to foreign policy, like having a blunt stand on terrorism, that we'll not engage with terrorism. And now, sir, recently unofficial talks with Taliban in the Moscow. So do you think that India should continue with a blunt stand or be like both sides?
See, I answered this question on upstairs as well. We can't engage directly with Taliban because of what they have done in the past, because of everything that's happened. I see Kandahar and all of that. We can't engage with them. But at the same time, Afghanistan is very important for us. It's strategically located, it's an important place, there's so much that is connected to Afghanistan that we can't ignore it. And also, we can't ignore it because of Pakistan's proximity to Afghanistan and what they can do in Afghanistan, which can have an impact on India, like it was in 20 years ago. So we can't engage with them directly because of the history and because of all the problems that have arisen out of the relationship. But we need to engage with them indirectly. We need a place at the high table so that we know exactly what is going on there, because there's a lot at stake for us in that particular place.
My question is like giving such statements like we don't promote terrorism, we not get on one table. Do you think that they are contradicting us?
But Taliban is not terrorists. They are not terrorists. No, they are not declared terrorists. Yes.
Somehow, sir, they are not officially
Al Qaeda is what the problem, where the terrorism is.
That region, sir, engaging with non-state actors.
We are not engaging with them. That's what I'm saying. We are not engaging with them at all. But we need to also know firsthand what is happening. No, we can't rely only on our allies every time to come and tell us what is happening. Because we are a major player there in Afghanistan. And what happens in Afghanistan is of major concern to us, more so because of what Pakistan wants to do there. So that's why we need to keep our eyes and ears open. So it's better if we hear it firsthand than if you heard me, you will go and tell your friend outside tomorrow. Will it convey the same message? That's what it is. Yes, anyone? Can I move to 370?
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
My question is, how Middle East administration differs from Indian administration, and how best Middle East upholds the basic human rights in terms of providing health, education and shelter to the common peoples?
Common people they don't care about. They are citizens, they do a lot. So if you are, and that's why they don't give citizenship to anybody, because their citizens are treated extremely well. You don't have to do anything. Just have to sit at home, money will come to you automatically. That's how the common citizens are treated there. I mean, their nationals are treated there. The others, of course, have to do their work, and how their political establishment is different from us. Most of them are monarchies. We are elected, democratically elected government. Okay. Yeah. Okay, she's saying Eritrea is going to be the next Dubai in 20 years. I said that. Okay, yeah.
We also know that China has established a military base in Djibouti.
Yes.
Is it because Chinese vision for the future, and also that it's a choke point there?
It's a choke point there, and also because of Somalia here, all your piracy and all of that happens here. So it's important to have a base in Djibouti, because what happens then is, in Djibouti, this is Somalia, Horn of Africa, okay? All the piracy and all the problems come from here. This is a small place called Djibouti here. All right. So it's important to have this base to keep these waters in. Our oil comes from here. This soil has to go from here all the way through the Straits of Malacca and all of that and come here to China. So for them, 86% of their energy security comes from this region.
Okay.
So for them, it is important to keep this place safe.
So that place doesn't matter to India much, that choke point?
That choke point doesn't matter too much for India. See, if we get this connected, if we get this through, it doesn't matter too much to us. We'll get our oil from here.
Okay. And if Eritrea is going to be the Dubai in next 20 years, is India doing something to gain from it in that region?
We are doing something in Djibouti. We are doing something in Eritrea. It's in the initial phases. It's still not announced. But we are taking this region very, very seriously. We are engaging in Ethiopia a lot. So we are doing something there.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Okay. When was 370 abrogated? Sorry? You are all wrong. What kind of UPSC aspirants are you? 370 was never abrogated. Certain sections of 370 were revoked. Okay, and that's why there is no special status for Jammu and Kashmir. So what about 370 is it that you want to know? I'm not going to speak about the domestic implications and the domestic aspects right now, because I don't think it is right for us to go into it at the moment, because the matter is being dealt with by the government, the matter is being dealt with by the concerned people. The poor LGs have only taken over 10 days ago. Give them some time, let them decide, let them do what they have to do. It was definitely a bold decision. If it was not done now, it could never have been done, because you need the kind of mandate that the government has now to go ahead with a bold decision like this. Should it have been done, if you are asking me personally, I say yes, because for 70 years, we have tried absolutely everything in this particular region. Soft power, engaging, you try to do everything that we possibly can, nothing has worked. So, is this going to work? Too early to say, because we cannot really judge and say what happens in the near future. Let time take its own course and we'll know exactly what happens here. But it was definitely the right thing to do, because everything else was tried and this particular issue had to go forward. And the people, Ladakh, have always said that they have been given stepmotherly treatment, because they have not had much representation in the state, in the erstwhile state, and that's why they needed this, and it was the right thing to do. What we have done diplomatically has been brilliant. There have been several European countries, several Western countries, several countries in West Asia who have had problems with our stand here, But the moment the decision was taken, our diplomatic community went into overdrive, ensured that we won the trust of the other nations, ensured that people like UAE, people like Saudi, people like US, people like several other countries also came out openly in support of us. And even at the UN, only 3 countries went against us. I think that's a great strike rate as far as India is concerned. We've done very well. So, of course, we know through all of this, we got to know who our true friends are, who our enemies also are, or people who are against us are. And we've taken steps to deal with them and to sort out issues with them as well. And I'm sure things will turn around and things will happen. But as far as the internal aspects, internal dynamics of this is concerned, it's too early to really comment and say which way it's going to go. I've already said that it's the best thing. I mean, it had to be done at some point in time because we are one nation at the end of the day. We have Bharat. And that. Any questions? Anvil? No, it's interesting. It's, you know, good question. Very interesting because, you know, they have gone in for the Puducherry model for Jammu and Kashmir, but they have gone for the Chandigarh model in Ladakh. Do you understand or no? So that's very interesting. So I guess at some point, at some level, you know, the message also to be sent out is that your interests are going to be taken care of. Give us some time. You'll have elections. You'll have that process also in place in due course of time. They could have done the same thing that they did in Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir as well. With the kind of mandate that this government has, who's going to question or who's going to stop? Yeah? Anyone else? I'm not a legal expert. I cannot answer that question. I think JSIDP, you watch my show, JSIDP would have answered that question in a better way. No, I mean, I don't want to comment on things that I'm not comfortable with or not confident about because I don't want to mislead you. Anyone else?
Sir, my question is regarding illegal migrants. We have seen a very blunt stand by the Donald Trump and also by the Germans. Are we on the same lines with respect to Rohingya crisis and Bangladesh and also by conducting NRC specifically concerned to Assam?
The official description that has been given is that the Rohingyas are a threat to the country. I've spoken to several former generals who have served and who know the history, who know the issue extensively. They have, I mean, all this off camera, of course, so they wouldn't lie to me or they wouldn't say anything otherwise. It's not like they are anyone's puppets. But they did say that they are a threat because they come from very, very poor backgrounds. They have nothing. So it's very easy to influence them by just giving them few hundred or thousand rupees. They are so desperate that they are willing to do anything. They just care about their stomach being fed or they care about someone showing them some kind of humanity because they live in inhumane conditions. So they are definitely a threat. Would we want someone who is a threat to us to live amongst us?
Thank you, sir.
Sorry.
Sir, you said they want if anyone supports them they are ready to go for them. You are saying, can we use them as proxy against Pakistan?
I don't think the Indian government wants to do that. We are not into that business. So see, this has been a long standing demand as far as the Sikhs are concerned. They've always wanted this because it's a very, very holy shrine for them. Imagine you can touch something but you can't.
You can see.
You can see something but you can't touch it. When you're hungry, someone's bringing and giving some nice food in front of you but you can't eat it. So it's like that for them. It's a very, very, you know, holy shrine. So they can see it every day but they can't really go there. So it's been a long standing demand as far as the Sikhs are concerned. And they have decided, okay, fine, we'll open it, we'll do this. We have to be careful though. Pakistan, nothing. that comes from Pakistan can be taken on face value. Because in the past also when we've had exchanges like this, they have kept back few of our people there without us even knowing, formed some lookalikes and sent them into India. Later on when they were apprehended, killed and all that, when the post-mortem was done, they realized that they were Pakistanis.
We should be like careful on security front.
Of course, we have to be.
And then can we see it as like a new chapter in talks with Pakistan?
Talks will not happen. We have been very, very clear as far as Pakistan is concerned. That if you want to talk,
no terror.
No terror.
Thank you, sir.
Anyone else?
Speaking of the bold decisions, what would be your stand on making Hindi as a national language?
Hindi as a national, my God. No comments. Next question, please.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. It's me. Sir, considering the present constitutional and political deadlock in UK, what do you think is the future of Brexit?
It doesn't concern, it doesn't matter, no issues, doesn't impact us in any way.
So from Brexit point of view, not from Indian point of view per se, but from Brexit point of view, what do you think would be the future considering, I mean, will there be one more election, referendum in favor of Brexit?
See, if there is one, I think at least the people will be in a better position to decide whether they really want Brexit or not. When it happened, when the referendum happened, they were only going by sentiment. They were like, hoo ha, that's all. They didn't really know exactly what it was and what it is going to be and what it can do. So I think they should have one. And I think the Britishers will be better advised, better prepared to decide what they need to do. I don't think they'll go for Brexit if there is one.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Sir, my question is about Kartarpur corridor. So, I mean, if you look at the tension between India and Pakistan right now, but Pakistan is more curious about completing it very soon. I mean, they have already done it. And recently, there is a statement by Imran Khan saying that they don't even need the passport from Indians to enter it. So, what might be the strategy behind
that? That is good. No, he doesn't want passport because he'll
but Indians are saying they need the passport elsewhere as the OCI card for the Indians.
Because for us, it's a bigger security implication than it is for Pakistan.
Mm-hmm. No. My question is, at this point in time, there is a lot of tension, but they are showing more interest in
why they are showing interest and why they want to engage with India. Because Pakistan has been sidelined by everybody. Even when Imran Khan went with a begging bowl, he found it so difficult to get money from the people who were traditionally his allies, trusted, friends, loyalists, whatever you call it. Even China didn't give him money initially. So he does, it's all about economics at the end of the day. He has no money. So he's trying to improve relations, he's trying to send out a message to the world that even though India is not bothered or concerned about me, I'm extending an olive branch, I'm trying to do so much, please come to my rescue. That is what it is.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes. No, wait. Someone was not asked questions.
Hello. Sir, here.
Ah.
So, that trade war between India and China, US and China, will it good or bad for India?
It's actually good for India if we can ensure that we can up our manufacturing, if we can ensure that we can make it advantageous to us. The problem is we are so slow to act, by the time we act, the trade war will be over.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
What kind of preparations you need before starting big picture?
Okay, you know what? I've had two or three questions like that. Good, funny question. Good to talk about those aspects as well. Since my time is till 2:00, I will take all topic related questions till 2:00. I'll give you 15 minutes grace to talk about anything non-topic related. Yes.
Sir, after the Article 370 issue, what is the future of investment and policies will going to invest in Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh region, because there is a so many separatist people are there when we compare to normal any other states in India. What will be the future we can predict in Jammu and Kashmir?
I'll tell you. See, I'm no soothsayer, or I'm not a someone sitting with a magic crystal ball in front of me to predict the future. But the problem area is going to be this area. This area you forget about. This area is going to see development. This area is going to see everything, because it's a beautiful place. And tourism is going to kick off here. The Taj is going to go and open one hotel there. ITC is going to go soon. I mean, I don't know. I don't know anyone at Taj or ITC, but looking at the beauty of the place, I'm sure they will go immediately, because there isn't anyone there at the moment. So they'll all go there. So people also will go there. I mean, if you've not gone, you should go there. It's a beautiful place. I mean, it feels like you're not in India. And this place is going to be the problem, but this can be handled. See, at the end of the day, if you try and keep the separatists away, if you keep the militants away, if the people, what do the people want at the end of the day? Peace and money. If the government can give them peace and money, they'll only kick out the separatists. They'll only kick out the militants. Let's give them some time. See, the thing is, when this happened, it was not like it was going to be an overnight solution. You have to give it some time before we judge, before we decide whether it was good or bad or wrong. Let's give it some time to, like a plant, you give it some time to grow, no? Tree, and then you get fruit. Let's see what happens. It's too early to judge right now. Yeah.
So, considering the growing bonhomie between US and India, can we afford to ruffle the Russian feathers?
And like I said, see, we've got good Vladivostok. So, we are not ruffling any feathers. We are keeping it strong.
Could see the effects when Pakistan and Russia had their military exercises, and even the big summit in India where, like, Pakistan was not declared as a state of state or something like that. I mean, the Russians and Chinese, they denied the same. So, there we could see the effects.
See, at the end of the day, we can't do without Russia. Okay? The Americans are not going to give you the best of technologies. Whatever bonhomie, whatever it is, best technology is not going to come into your hand. The Russians are the only ones who are giving you that. Our fighter jets that we have, the limited ones that we still have that can fly, that are not coffins, the Russians are giving the spare part. So without Russia, we can't do anything. And Russia also, don't forget, at the end of the day, is going through a bad economic problem. So they too need friends, they too need allies. So they will go to anybody who is willing to side with them. And we have not forgotten Russia. Whole Vladivostok summit was only that. We don't want to neglect Russia as well.
Businesses will come there.
Where?
Jammu and Kashmir. New businesses, new opportunities will be open. So people will migrate there. So the place of those people are basically the Kashmirians. Like their culture will get diluted. So how do we tackle that? Like to control migration? Because new businesses will come, there will be a flooding. Like,
It's going to be limited, no? We still don't know the contours of what it's going to be. Like I said, let's give it some time, because they could have easily done that if they wanted to control everything. If they did not want to give democracy back, they would have had the same status as Ladakh or Jammu and Kashmir as well. They would have made it a UT without a legislature. Why do they have a legislature? Because at some point in time or somewhere, they believe that they want to give back democracy at some point in time. So they'll frame their own laws, they'll frame whatever it is. I mean, like Himachal, Karnataka, can you buy land? Agricultural land if you're not a farmer? Same thing.
Hello, sir.
Where? Yes, please.
So as per the economic survey, the experts said that India should go for the investment driven economy. But as per present issues are, you are not dealing with any big trade with the USA also, Russia also, it is in the talks. Is the present foreign policies working as per the investment is concerned?
We are trying, it's not like we are not trying. There are people who want to invest, there are people who will come eventually. Germany has invested heavily in India. Germany wants to invest in clean technologies and cleaner fuels and all of that. I think they have given $1 billion. For that. So, it will happen. It's not like something that will not happen. But investment has not picked up because of some things that have happened, no, previously. I mean, I don't want to go into history and go into those issues. Investment will pick up eventually. Let's hope that it happens sooner rather than later. But the foreign market is definitely focused on India because it's a market that they don't want to let go of. Yes? Okay, time up.
One thing. China is very close to Russia, that we know. Okay. Can India become that much close to China?
No.
Instead of making neighboring enemies, can't we be friends with China permanently like Russia
is? You can't trust China. No, look, go back to history. See what happened in 61.
So, instead of using that bargaining power that India is a big market, can't we supersede China and...
China is a bigger market. We can't do that because, see, the thing is, we can't blindly trust China because of history. History also is something that we need to go into. And history tells us that China is someone that we can't openly and blindly trust. So, why will we start doing that now? Whenever we deal with China, we have to be a little cautious. Not just 61. Look at what they have done with Pakistan. Look at how they have used Pakistan as a proxy. Why do you think China cares about Pakistan?
For the time being only.
They are not bothered about Pakistan. They only have Pakistan to Kujli India.
Okay. Done.
Next. Yes. Okay. Last question. Last question.
Sir, at international forums, India always raises the issue of terrorism and it keeps on raising it despite not much happening on grounds. Does that raises, will it come and bite us back? Because as T.S.R. Subramaniam, who was a former officer, who has told in 1960s, 70s, Indian diplomats used to raise the J&K issue all the time, which resulted in other countries' diplomats and members not approaching because the same issue will be raised again. So, India approach using terrorism as a plank to speak at every opportunity or every forum that is there, is it not being a counterproductive measure for Indians?
So, I'll tell you what, from the issue of terrorism, it's affecting everybody, not like it's affecting only India, right? So, you look at Europe affected, you look at Africa, they have their own problems in Nigeria, Somalia, South Sudan, everywhere they have problems. Look at the US, they have their own issues. So, terrorism is something that is affecting the entire world. So, they are not going to take it lightly. It's going to be a problem that they need to root out, they are going to need to deal with. And India is raising the particular issue because India is facing the brunt from Pakistan the most. So, why shouldn't we raise it? We should keep the issue up. Okay, yes.
Hello sir. Thanks a lot for being here and it's an honor to be in front of you of your stature and everything.
Thank you for having me. The sir, honor is mine.
Thank you. I have two questions regarding the same thing, the foreign policy. So, I'll give you one example only, Antarctic Treaty or we can say Outer Space Treaty, both of them were signed in 1960s. So, it means the vision of those policy makers was way beyond the current time. Do you think that Indian diplomacy or Indian policy making is lagging behind to see the future?
I think we have enough troubles in the present that we need to deal with. If we can get those sorted, then only then can we think about the future because we have several issues. Do you think we don't have issues?
Yes, we have, but at the same time, let's say polymetallic nodules in the Indian Ocean region. First of all, Indian Ocean region, I don't know what was happening behind 20 years. But even though we have now those, we don't have the technology to harness it.
We don't have the money also.
Exactly. So, do you think that it was like it is a continuing process that either we don't have money, either we don't have the vision, either we don't have the diplomacy.
That's why we are moving towards $5 trillion economy. No, when we become $5 trillion economy by 2024, we'll have the money to do all of these things. See, at the end of the day, it's as simple as this. It comes down to money. If you have the money, you can do anything and everything. If you don't have the money, you can't do anything.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Welcome. Okay. Right? Yes. No, we are for opening markets. We are for multilateralism. That's what India has always maintained. But you need to have the right kind of FTAs, no? You can't have an FTA with a block or a region which is going to adversely affect you. It will, but unless our fellows pick up their software, it's not like we don't know their technology. We know what they are doing, we know what their model, we know everything. Yes, but right now it's not the right moment, considering the local dynamics, to open up the markets on the east. It's the right time to open up the markets on the west. And that's what we are doing. We are balancing it out somewhere, no? That's what's happening. Okay? Done? Thank you very much. Okay, so thank you. Let's talk about the story now. The Mahabharata passages that I gave you from Mahabharata. So what is the, who's the hero? Okay. Good answer. Okay. So who's the hero? So okay, Dronacharya, Arjuna, dog, okay. Sorry? Win-win for both Drona and Arjuna, okay? Okay, Eklavya, okay? Okay, and what's the diplomatic message? Very good. Following law of land, okay, yes, okay? Giving both sides. Okay, good, all bright minds, yes, the hero is Dronacharya. Why? Simple. You use strategy, get rid of your enemy when you possibly can, at the initial stage only, when you know that this person can be a threat to you at some point in time, you keep him away, sideline him. Let him not be a threat at any point in time. And self-interest, which is national interest, always first. So, use any strategy, means, methods, techniques possible to ensure that the interests of India are met and safeguarded first. That is what our foreign policy also is. Simple. Okay? Alright, thank you very much. You guys have been a great audience.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving time and sharing so many things. And sir, please be seated. Sir, and now I will invite Vinay sir to say thanks and say some few words about sir or Ignite and about today's session.
Once again, I would like to thank on behalf of INSIGHTSIAS, thank you very much for this wonderful session, and also you have been so wonderful, the crowd. There were so many questions, actually I think you have been reading international relations so seriously, right? the questions were very specific and to the point, and it has resulted in solving of so many doubts. And I'm so happy that we are taking forward these Ignite at Insights sessions. Particularly today's session was so lively, and you know, and the love you have towards him is incredible. So we hope this association continues, and we would like to invite him in future also for specific talks related to foreign policy, economy, and not about politics at you know, other issues. You could have opened up more also, provided if he was not there in Rajya Sabha, maybe. Right. So, but anyway, thanks a lot for coming here and, enlightening all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.